strong. Your transition was pretty smooth. It feels like for fighters, I mean, we've seen this time and again in the fight game, it's very hard to say goodbye, right?
Transition's tough.
Yeah.
This is,
did you ever have tough moments?
Our identity is wrapped up in that soul endeavor, and that's a difficult thing to just let go of and walk away from. We're not normal humans.
Right.
So to think you're just going to throw us back into the civilian world and it's going to be honky-dory doesn't work that way. I've been fortunate in the transitions that I've had, both leaving the military, leaving wrestling. I had other things to go to, leaving MMA. You know, I had active
targeted
adults,
near you, agent.
Things that I built from that that helped make that transition easier and smoother. I had a new purpose. I had something else to focus on, and that's what a lot of our guys, whether they're pro athletes or soldiers, when they transition, it's very difficult.
Do you ever have any moments where you're like, man, because I've heard it sort of compared to like drugs, right? Like you need that drug, like the drug, like the fans and the attention and the build up,
the adrenaline.
Yeah.
Walking out of that tunnel.
Did you ever feel like you were missing it?
No, I felt pretty comfortable with it. I think it was the right time for me, and it took me a while to come to that. Come to that conclusion.
After the Machida fight?
No, I had decided.
The UAV.
It started entering my mind for the James Toney fight.
Okay, really?
Yeah, and every injury I'd ever had in my wrestling and fighting career flare up during that camp for no particular reason. That was the first time I ever thought, man, maybe my body's telling me I need to start thinking about the future and doing something else. And then, you know, obviously that fight was an important fight, but not a terrible tactical fight.
Right.
And I felt like Lyoto was definitely a very tactical fight and one that I, win or lose, I could go out on.
Okay. But you knew that night?
I knew beforehand. I just didn't tell anybody.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we did the book. The last round was Sarah Levin.
Yeah.
She volunteered at the camp. There was only two people that knew I made the decision to retire. I knew if I told everybody, made it public, it would have taken on a life of its own.
You don't want that.
I wanted to focus on the fight.
Okay. Do you have regrets that your last fight was a loss?
No. I mean, you can't think of things that way.
Right.
Some of those losses that I suffered in my career were the most important thing that could have happened to me at that time. You know, I got all these bright, shiny new teeth for acting now, so things turned out the way they're supposed to.
Do you foresee, I know you've gone to Washington and you've tried to fight for fighter rights and things of that nature. Do you foresee in your lifetime any scenario in which former retired fighters, especially of your stature, of Chuck's stature, of Tito's stature, where there's any sort of system in place that helps with the transition, like the NFLPA, like the NBAPA?
Yeah, and obviously I'm part of the MMAFA, the Fighters Association, and we're lobbying hard to get the Ollie Act amended to cover us as combative sports athletes across the board, not just boxers, and create some transparency in the industry with the amount of money that promoters are making. So they're shaking, negotiating our share of that.
Yeah,
which doesn't happen.
Are there legs right now?
Through that same product, look at SAG. As a member of SAG, that's not like it fits fighting the best. There's a bunch of studios out there all trying to make films. There's this pool of actors that they're trying to pull from. They have health insurance. They have retirement plans. They've created minimum standards for treatment and pay through SAG. I think that's something we should aspire to as fighters.
Do you feel like we're moving in that direction?
I feel like we're trying to educate the fighters, and that's been the biggest challenge, getting the fighters to see the merit in getting on board with this and coming together. Without us, there's no show.
Right.
It's that simple.
Yeah.
So if we come together, unite, and use that as leverage, I think we can get a better deal. And that's the point.
Are you surprised that it's taken the fighters so long to see this?
Because
sometimes, no?
We are very egocentric. That's what makes us good at what we do.
Right.
It's never going to happen to me. And, you know, we don't think forward enough, I think. And so that's kind of what we're up against.
So you're trying to essentially say, like, look, I have gone through the entire gauntlet, right? It will happen to you. Like the ride ends at some point,
yep.
No matter how good you are.
Absolutely. It does not last forever. You have to recognize you have a short window of opportunity to make this kind of money, to be a professional like this, and eventually, realistically, you have to call it quits at some point.
Sometimes it feels like the media cares about this more than the fighters, because I feel like we talk about it, and then you ask the fighters about it, and they say essentially what you're saying, like, I fought tooth and nail to get to this point. I can't
afford to get blacklisted. I can't afford
exactly.
This is the battle. Not enough guys to step up and be willing to put it on the line. Yeah, it's one thing for me. I'm already retired. My time is over.
Right.
I'm happy to lend my name to this fight. And it is a fight. But at the end of the day, we need the guys that are current, that are right now, that are in it, to step up and be part of this.
And you feel like it's still alive, right?
Still alive, still happening.
Okay.
Obviously, there's been some jockeying, political jockeying, things going on, being lobbied against, and significant money is being thrown, against getting things amended and set up, which, I get, it'll change the sport, but in a lot of ways, certainly from a fighter perspective, it makes it better.
So you occupy your time, you do keep all 10 shows, right? You'll be at all 10?
I will be at all 10.
All of them, ESPN, PFL, debuts this Thursday. Still acting.
Just finished a film in New Mexico.
Oh, really?
Called The Manson Brothers, Midnight Zombie Massacre.
Okay.
It was a blast. Had a lot of fun doing it. Max Martini directed.
Okay.
He's, I met him years ago doing The Unit.
Okay.
We've been friends for a long time, and his second directorial debut, so getting a chance to work with him was a lot of fun and a great cast of guys.
Did you enjoy the process
Target
of making films?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
An interesting process, not something I ever saw myself doing. I think I was in Tiny Tim in the sixth grade in Christmas Carol. Played Tiny Tim.
Really? Wow, you got the lead role.
That was it.
Wow.
Spent my whole life as an athlete kind of boxing up my emotions, putting them to the side and going out and doing what I trained to do.
Right.
So now in this process, they want you to find a way to emote real things and be genuine and in these made-up scenarios, try and find a way to tell the truth, which is the real key and the trick.
Who first introduced you to acting?
My first movie experience was Cradle to the Grave in 1998.
Wow.
And the call came to the UFC. They were looking for some authentic cage fighters for the cage fighting scene in that movie with DMX and Jet Li.
Okay.
So me and Chuck and Tito all got a chance to be in that movie. I had one line in the movie. And Chuck and Tito actually fought each other in the movie, which was interesting because that was what everybody was trying to make happen back
then. Right.
Which never did happen, at least for a while.
Right.
So that was my first experience, first chance to see the process. I was immediately intrigued. It was an MMA movie called No Rules, Frank Shamrock, Lindland Henderson, and Jerry Anderson, Pam's brother.
Okay.
Jerry wrote this, and David Dunn was the lead. It was a low budget, but it was a great experience. I got to play the good bad guy in a movie. It was, for me at that time, it was important. I needed more experience, more chance to develop new tools for skills.
I didn't know that.
I don't know if he ever did any acting.
Oh, okay.
But, obviously,
there was one.
She did a cameo in the film because it was him. He wrote it, and it was his first and maybe his only directing.
Really?
Yeah, so.
How many have you done at this point?
Around 35 feature films.
Really?
Yeah,
wow.
Somewhere around there.
What's your favorite so far?
Well, I mean, it's tough to beat The Expendables.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a great time doing Scorpion King 2.
Right.
Obviously, that was a huge property for The Rock, for Dwayne Johnson, and
Target neutralized. Good work.
A good learning experience for me as well.
Will there be a fourth Expendables?
They're saying this summer.
Really?
So we're still waiting to see the script and find out
part of it.
Well, yeah, Toll Road's still alive. So,
wow.
Yeah, that's always the first thing you do is go.
Yeah. Are you alive?
Yeah.
That's another one down.
So
good job, Agent.
They're saying they're going to start shooting this summer?
Start shooting this summer, yeah.
Wouldn't you know by now? I mean, it's getting kind of close, no?
This has been going back and forth for the last couple years.
Okay.
The Sly's just been so busy with Escape Plan, Creed 2, and now a new Rambo, I think it's finally clear to come around, and it sounds like they've got a script, and I'm excited to read it and see what we're doing and who's coming back.
Yeah.
What's going on.
And where do you live these days?
Vegas.
Still Vegas.
Still Vegas.
Not L.A.?
No. Still, I have a place in L.A., and obviously part of the crew at Unbreakable with Glazer and the guys there.
How often do you spend there? So Jake Glazer, the great NFL reporter, also owns a gym there.
Mm-hmm.
With others as well, right?
I'm one of those others.
You're one of the others, okay. But it's like a VIP gym. Is that fair?
It is. It's
I can't just walk in there.
It's an exclusive boutique performance training center.
Okay.
Very unique place, and has a very interesting vibe to it. It's a cool place.
How would you describe that vibe?
It's a little bit like Cheers.
Okay.
Everybody walks through the door, you know their name. Their name gets shouted, and then it's like being part of a fight team. We're doing the same kind of strength conditioning and performance training that I did as a fighter, training iterated for fights, and then we finish every workout with some form of MMA on the mats, doing some form of drilling, or that's our cardio. That's how we finish every workout.
And it's all famous people?
There are a lot of famous people in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
But if you're not a famous person, you could still go. You just have to
still go. Sure.
Pay a lot of money.
It's exclusive. Let's just say it's that way.
But how's the like what's the process in terms of getting in?
Come in. Yeah, it's an open door.
Oh, is it?
Yeah,
okay.
Sure.
Interesting. But if it's an open door, how is it exclusive?
Because because the cost makes it expensive.
All right. Fair enough.
Yeah.
I heard Jay say recently that Chris Pratt hits harder than you. See that?
Jay is always poking fun at me.
Why?
Because that's how we roll.
Okay. All right.
Jay's great. I've not met a more loyal guy than Jay Glazer. But Chris is amazing. And actually grew up in the same neck of the woods where I grew up in Washington, near north of Seattle.
Okay.
And his wrestling coach in high school went to Oklahoma State, where I went to college.
Right.
He was the class before me.
So okay.
We never really crossed paths. His name's Brent Barnes, and he's a great guy, too. But I crossed paths with Chris when Chris was in high school, and I was coaching at Oregon State. Brett brought a bunch of his kids down to our Oregon State camp, and I guess I called Chris out and used him as a
really?
Demonstration
wow.
or technique. He remembered that. I didn't remember that until obviously not much later. It's Chris Pratt.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
A little bit different time. And so it was a really funny story. And now Chris trains at the gym and get to wrestle with him and work out with him on occasion. And
wow.
He's great.
That must be amazing
he's
for him.
Guy, physical guy.
Really?
Yeah.
Is he that strong? I mean, obviously the...
No, his wrestling is still there. He's still
really?
Great arm drag. He moves well, really enjoys it. That's the thing about wrestling. It's one of those sports, you know. Ben Askren just talked about that. It
right.
builds character, and once you get that mindset, you look at the world that way the rest of your life.
Yeah, so he just goes into state shape.
Yeah.
Right. The Sligo there?
Wiz Khalifa's in there. Sly comes in there. Once in a while.
They
put on 25 pounds, and looks great. Demi Lovato trains in there. Right.
A lot of crew
in there, yeah.
What a crew. That's amazing. So you spend your time doing movies, doing PFL, doing Unbreakable. Anything else you got? Or is that the life of Randy?
Extreme Couture is where it all started.
Right.
So
are you still going there?
I'm at Extreme Couture. You know, Ryan has picked up the mantle there and is kind of running with that. Him and Eric Nixick do a great job of running the gym. So if I'm in Vegas, I'm at Extreme Couture. If I'm in L.A., I'm at Unbreakable. But I'm in neither of those places very often,
right.
to be honest, on the road a lot.
It feels, and correct me if you feel otherwise, it feels like for a moment Extreme Couture was kind of down, and it has experienced a revitalization.
Yeah, well, I think there's an ebb and flow to any gym,
right.
you know, especially a fight gym. And when I retired, a whole bunch of guys went other places to find workout partners. I wasn't in there grinding out camps, especially some
table,
of the later guys
table.
At that time that had gravitated there because I was in
the on the mark.
And, so that we kind of... It was a dip. Some guys went other places.
God damn it, these plates are Swiss cheese.
The training they needed. Dennis Davis came in.
Up here.
One of my personal guys from Team Quest. And I was trying to get him put over and give him the credibility that he needed to continue to coach. Robert Fallis came in and obviously helped with that because Robert was his mentor.
Okay.
And Dennis, you know, literally gave up some salary to find a way to get Robert in there.
Wow.
And Robert was a huge piece of kind of the resurgence, which he attracted Misha Tate and then so many other big stars that were still competing actively. And obviously we're all devastated with what happened with Robert, and you know Dennis is, and all the other guys are still there and still doing what they do so well. So
you feel like obviously that was, I remember speaking to you just a couple of days later, that was a horrible tragedy. Do you feel like the gym has been able to get back on its feet, or are you still missing his presence?
I think the gym's obviously, we're always going to miss Robert,
yeah.
but the gym is still doing very, very well. Eric and Ryan, like I said, have stepped up. Dennis is still in there doing all the things that Robert taught him to do, basically.
Okay.
And so the gym is doing very, very well.
Is that the kind of thing, like, do you think about Robert a lot when and the signs and what could I have done?
It's tough because knowing Robert as well as I do, I understand how he came to that decision. All the factors that led him there. And you'd like to think that maybe there was something he could have said and done, but honestly, I don't think there was.
Really?
I think that this he planned this very meticulously. I don't, you know.
Was it a spur of the moment thing?
No, I don't think so. No, this was an event coming. This was.
Why?
I think survivor's guilt of his own when his brother committed suicide. So,
that's the target
agent. Trouble dealing with. A lot more family dynamic than too, but that was, I think, the biggest thing and the thing that pushed him over the edge the most.
Some have talked to me about Jehovah's Witness and that role, and it's like, you feel like you subscribe to that?
That was a huge piece of the mechanics of what ultimately led him down that road, what affected his brother the way it did, and ultimately him as well.
I was just at the gym 2 months ago because it was a one championship event there.
Yeah.
And I saw Ryan there, and I used to come back. It's been a while since I've been back there, but
packed, and you go in there, it's packed. Kids' classes to the pro practice, the whole thing.
And how many are there right now? Because I know you had one in Toronto.
The one in Toronto is still there, and that's a licensing agreement with the Toronto gym.
The main one for you is?
The main one is Vegas. That's the only other one that's left. I had 10 at one time when the first year that we opened the Extreme Couture in Vegas. Wow. And then in 08, when the economy turned, a bunch of them went away.
Okay. What was your fate? Like, when you think back, because I remember those times when you launched Extreme Couture and things were going, like, it seemed like the sport was really exploding. I'd say that it's not now. But for you and your involvement in the sport as a fighter, what's your favorite time, your favorite era, your favorite year? Is there a time where you think back and you're like, man,
target down.
It was great.
Good job.
Those were the glory days.
I'm fortunate in that I got to kind of compete through what most people see.
It's like you earned yourself another bounty.
Yep.
Well done.
Kind of on the cusp of the transition where everybody started cross-training, and I was kind of part of that whole thing. I think before that, you know, I came in UFC 13, and before that, everybody was out to prove that their martial arts style was the best martial arts style. And I think we quickly realized there was no one martial arts style that did or encompassed everything we needed.
Right.
So I was kind of part of that second crew of guys that recognized the need to cross-train. There were no MMA gyms then. We were going to 24-hour fitness or wherever to do our strength and conditioning, and hopefully getting on a wrestling mat or in a jiu-jitsu school somewhere to learn this other stuff, and going to the boxing gym for the striking or kickboxing gym for the striking. There was no MMA training center, so, you know, Lion's Den, Team Quest, a bunch of those things grew out of that need, out of the niche of being an MMA one-stop shop.
But in terms of, like, for you personally, is there a period where you, like, really felt like, man, this was the time of my life that you think back to?
I mean, the whole thing was such an amazing ride.
Okay.
And to enter something on a whim in 1997, literally because it was interesting and I saw guys I knew from the wrestling world that were doing it, and fortunate enough to get in back then, and then for it to just explode. My third show, my fourth fight, was for the championship of the world.
Yeah.
Like, what just happened?
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah. Who convinced you to enter it?
I had a friend, Jim Townsend.
Okay.
Who was another wrestler. Lived in Malibu, running a production company in Malibu, and we met at the College Invitational in State Line. Usually it's in Vegas, but that particular year it was at Buffalo Bills in State Line. And
okay.
He's like, oh man, did you see Coleman? Did you see Don Fry? You
wow.
know, in that MMA thing, you should do it. It was No Holds Barred back then.
Yeah.
You should do that. And I'm like, he's like, no, I know how to get the application. I'll send it in. And
wow.
That's how it started.
Really?
Yeah.
What, did you even watch it?
I had seen of Fry competing.
Yeah.
Obviously, Fry and I were teammates at Oklahoma State,
uh-huh.
So I was immediately intrigued with what he was doing there and what was going on, and that's what started it.
Wow, what do you think your life would be like if that never happened?
Because I would probably still be coaching at the collegiate level somewhere if MMA had not come along. I was the assistant coach at Oregon State back then. The head coach did not like MMA or the fighting. He thought it was bad for wrestling, and really kind of forced me to make a decision, which I wasn't very happy about at that time, but quickly realized I'm glad he made me choose one or the other, because I would have tried to do both, and it wouldn't have worked out.
So he basically said, you have to leave if you want to do this.
Who are you going to be? Are you going to be a wrestling coach, or are you going to be a fighter?
Wow. You chose fighting. Was that hard choice?
It was a scary choice. I had a family to support.
Right.
And, you know, that was a great job with great benefits. And, going to happen with MMA, so it was a bit of a risk to just jump out of a solid job and pursue MMA full time.
Do you think you would have been content if that was your life?
I think I would have.
Yeah.
But I also think that because I'd had the setbacks, both the NCAA finals wrestling and the Olympic trials, trying to make the Olympic team, that I was still hungry. I still wanted to compete, and that hunger drove me into MMA and trying my hand at this new sport.
I was talking about this with Ben before the show. So you were an alternate three times in the Olympics.
Four, actually.
Four. Okay. But you never... Did you ever actually go to the Olympics?
You know, I went and watched.
You watched, okay.
As a support, as part of the support staff, a workout partner, and scouting partner.
Yeah, what years?
88 was my first, so 88, 92, 96, and 2000.
Wow.
I went to... the 96 games were in Atlanta.
Yep.
I went to Spain. Mm-hmm. And I also went to Australia.
Wow. But you never...
Got to compete.
Do you consider yourself an Olympian? Because you were an alternate?
No. Wrestling is one of those pure sports. The alternates don't really... I mean, we're there to support the team.
Yeah.
But you don't get up, you know. I don't think it's ever happened, actually, where an alternate got pushed in. Once once those guys weigh in that first match,
right,
whatever happens to them after that, whether they win, lose, get hurt, there are no substitutes from that point on. So unless somebody got hurt the week before and couldn't weigh in that first time,
yeah,
there's no way an alternate's going to get to compete. Now, I made the world team, which is basically the Olympics in a non-Olympic year, four times, and wrestled at the world championships, and, you know, did well. I think the best I did was 97, right before the Belfort fight.
Uh-huh.
Placed ninth at the Worlds in Greco. Tons of fond memories.
Yeah. I wonder, I mean, he's going to be on in like 15, 20 minutes. DC, when he couldn't compete because of his kidneys, I wonder if the alternate got to step in 2000. And
I wonder because his issues prevented him from making weight. I think he actually tried to step on the scale, and I think at that point it's too late.
Oh, okay. To
put a substitute in there.
Okay.
So I think we just didn't get to compete at that weight.
Okay.
I mean, if he'd have been ill enough to say, look, I don't think I can do this, then we could have put a substitute in at that point.
Right.
But once he stepped on the scale, that's it.
Are you or Daniel Cormier the greatest Oklahoma State wrestler turned MMA fighter?
I don't know. I mean, Daniel's
what
amazing.
What a debate, huh?
Yeah, Daniel's amazing. And
did you think he would turn into this?
Did I think it would turn into sport?
No, did you think he would turn into the fight? I think he...
Oh, I absolutely believed he had...
Really?
100%. Had seen him in the gym, the way he implements his wrestling and his strengths into his fighting style, is those naturally heavy hands reminded me a little of Henderson.
Huh.
You know, I don't think Danny ever knew he could punch like that until he started punching him.
Right.
And he started knocking people on their butts. I don't know Daniel, and he was ever a big... You know, I don't think he was in a lot of trouble in the street fights.
Yeah, I truly believe that he's one or two in terms of the
he's fantastic. Amazing technician. Great. I love his personality, so.
Yes, he was supposed to fight Brock Lesnar, as you may have heard, that fell through.
Yeah.
You got to fight Brock Lesnar.
Yeah.
You believe him that he's done?
I don't know.
He says this all the time.
He said it a few times. Yeah. You know, and he's had some medical, the diverticulitis and some of those things that are genuinely tough things to deal with. But it's hard to say.
Yeah.
You know, what's making a headline and what's genuine?
What's negotiations, right?
Yeah.
When he hits you, like, with those paws.
The thing that's so deceptive about him is he's long.
Yeah.
I realize he looks so thick.
Yeah.
I think he's got him short.
Right.
He's very long.
He's got, like, an Inspector Gadget arm,
right?
Coming. That was the thing.
What was my undoing?
That did you remember? Because I remember, like, he just
rolled that punch,
right,
and it just kept coming in right by the ear
right,
and knocked me right out of my butt, so...
And those aren't the punches that necessarily, like, hurt the most, right? It's just the button.
Yeah, it was just a flash.
Right. Man. But in terms of, like, the behemoth of a man, you never fought anyone like him, right? Like, just trying to...
Serious trauma.
No, not as
right?
big and as athletic as he is.
Yeah.
It's rare to find a guy that size that can move that well. You know, obviously, Tim is a taller guy than Brock.
Right.
And as heavy, Tim's not as athletic. As well as Brock moves around.
Is the Tim fight the one that people want to talk to you about the most?
That's a lot of people's favorite.
Right.
Between the Tim fight and the Tito fight, I think those are the two that get brought up the most.
And you were slapping his butt?
Spanking him.
Yeah. Okay, spanking my bad. That was a great moment. You screwed up all their plans. Remember?
Yeah.
You were. Did you?
I think I was in that situation a few times.
Yeah. Like, oh, really? You felt that? You felt like the cards were stacked?
I was the fly in the ointment.
Yeah.
I think they weren't keen. He fell for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, he was their poster boy.
Right.
And they did not think that was going to go down that way. I'd heard stories that Meyer was literally jumping up and down, screaming no.
Really?
In the production trailer as I was winning that fight. And then obviously, you know, Fertitas and Dana bought the company in 2001. And I think, you know, I was the heavyweight champion at 39, almost 40 years old. When that happened, I think that was very marketable.
Immediate medical assistance
like
needed.
Always trying to find a way to get me beat or get me out of there, and it just didn't work out.
Do you remember the first time you met them, the Fertitas and Dana?
I had met Dana previous to them, that previous year in December in Japan. I was over there cornering Matt Lindland,
okay,
one of the last UFC Japans.
Okay.
And Dan Anderson did Pride.
Right.
And Dana was still representing Chuck and Tito at that time, and he was interested in me in picking me up. And I had just talked to the guys from Battle Management,
Peter
Levin, and then met Dana while I was there in Japan. And then when he came back, he let me know. I let him know that I chose to go with Battle. He said, well, I couldn't have represented you anyway. There's something coming down the pike. You're going to be excited about it. You know.
Oh, wow.
I can't say anything, but, and then obviously found out a month later that Bertita's bought the company and he was the new president.
Wow.
So it was, that definitely changed the sport.
Do you feel like the fact that you didn't choose him as a manager?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I think that was something he took personal, and
okay.
It wouldn't have worked out either way, obviously,
right.
Because he was in a position to be the new president of the organization.
And what about when you met the Fertittas? Do you remember that?
It was after that. You know, they started the big campaign to kind of rebrand the sport and,
right.
And take it to the next level. And that was the first time I met Lorenzo. I don't think I met Frank until actually one of the fights.
Okay.
Where he, you know, obviously came ringside to a lot of the fights.
Your son isn't competing anymore.
Ryan's fighting still with Bellator.
Yes.
Yeah.
When's the last time you fought?
November.
Okay.
In Israel.
That's right. Against Chaim Al-Ghazali. Will he fight again?
He has more fights on his car, on his contract. You know, it's really up to him.
Okay.
He's 36. He's been fighting 10 years. You know, I feel like he's looking at the end of it.
Yeah.
So it's really, again, one of those personal things. It's up to him. It's his life. You know, I know they're hankering to start a family and all of that, too. So I think all those are factors that he's considering right now.
Seeing him fight, like actually seeing your son fight, what is that like?
Well, you know, it started with wrestling. I watched him wrestle all through junior high and high school, and I got way more nervous for those matches than anything. So I think we kind of came with, you know, figured out how to deal with that. He being in the same sports.
Right.
If anything, dragging around the same last name was a burden.
Right.
He got a target on his back almost from the jump. So, I mean, he's just such a great kid, such a smart kid. He's taking all that in stride. Diligent, he has a genuine passion for the sport, so both as a father or a coach.
Did you find yourself getting very anxious when you were cornering him or watching him?
He just wanted to do well.
Right.
You see the work, you see, you know what he put into that, and you want him to do well. But you feel that way about any fighter that you're cornering, that you're coaching, that you're part of their process. So,
but it's got to be a little different when
there's
his son, right?
You know, there's always that added layer, you know, wearing the dad hat, too.
Sure.
So, most parents are like, oh my God, were you worried that he'd get injured? I'm like, I've been doing this for a long time. I've never seen anybody seriously injured. Nothing that didn't heal up the neck. I wasn't worried about him that way.
Okay.
I'm just happy that he found something that, you know, he was passionate about.
How many kids in total did you have?
I have three.
Any other children?
Amy is 34. She lives up in Portland.
Okay.
She got a degree in sociology, and she was working with handicapped folks, setting up their benefits and their treatment and stuff. August is 16.
Okay.
He just driving.
Wow.
This last month. So he's been doing martial arts for 7 or 8 years. A little jiu-jitsu, done a lot of karate. Trying wrestling for a season.
Got the
his thing.
Nice.
He's in high school now. We'll see if he comes back to wrestling, but I doubt it.
Cleaning
really
up the streets one bad guy at a time.
And the jiu-jitsu.
Nicely
any
done,
chance
Sheriff.
He actually fights?
Anything's possible. He's a big
interest?
Kid. He's a smart kid. But, you know, I don't know. I don't know. Again, going to push him anyway. It'll be his decision. If
would you
he
prefer
does.
He doesn't fight?
I just think he's such a smart kid.
Yeah.
He's got a lot of other options. He's a great musician, actually. He plays piano and guitar.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does he ever ask you questions?
You telling him he needs to learn how to sing.
Yeah. That's where the real money's at.
Yeah.
Does he ask you questions about the fight game where you get the sense that...
He watches his brother now.
Okay.
He never really watched me fight. He was too young
sure.
back then.
Does he ever ask you about the old fights, watching the old fights?
No.
Really?
No, he doesn't.
I feel like if my dad was Randy Couture, I'd want to talk to him about this, you know.
Not yet, anyway.
Okay.
Yeah. He seems to be more interested in the acting stuff.
Oh, interesting.
And, yeah, he loves to watch movies and TV, so I think he may have some interest there.
Okay.
We'll see.
What about Chael? Chael was here a couple of weeks ago, and he said that he's fighting Leonardo Machida next. He said the impetus for this fight, his motivation for this fight, is he saw you get kicked in the face, and he said on that night, I will avenge that loss some way, somehow. And so that is his driving factor for this fight. How about that? Did you know that?
I had not heard that.
Okay.
But,
sometimes Chael likes to tell stories in self-fight, but it's a good
Chael
story.
Literally since he was in high school.
Yeah.
Tried to recruit him to Oregon State. And then, you know, when he started MMA, when he was on the Greco team, and me and Dan, he was one of our workout partners back then, and he ended up being an alternate on the Olympic team, I think, through that experience. And so I just, you know, he's great. I enjoy watching him. And I enjoy the persona that has become Chael Sonnen.
Yes. Was he like that?
No.
No, not at all, right?
I think he shocked all of us with those first interviews. Holy crap, is that Chael?
Yeah. Where did this come from?
Yeah.
Do you still keep in touch?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he messes up now and then, and we still stay in touch for sure.
Still go back there?
Go back to Oregon to
Okay, okay.
And then occasionally Portland to see my daughter, Amy.
Does he ask you anything about, you know, fighting Pachita?
Oh, he hasn't yet.
Not yet.
He always usually, you know, fight Pedro when he's with
the other
kids. Yeah, he hits me up. What do you think? You know, what should be my approach? What should I sharpen? You know, some things don't go away. I've been part of that process with him since the beginning.
Does that make you feel good that he reaches out?
I like that, yeah.
Message health is critical.
I always appreciate him and the fact that he's interested in my perspective.
As far as youngsters right now in the sport, are there any that you are excited about? Are there any that you feel like have it?
Oh, there's so many. I got a gym full of them.
Really?
You know, Kevin Lee and then on down the line, Danny Davis Jr. There's just a bunch of young kids.
I'm still sort of in awe that we had Ashgren and Couture back to back in studio. Holy smokes. I mean, when you're sitting here talking to Randy Couture, like, you feel the history just oozing out of his pores. Like, I mean, that is a living legend right there. Considering what this man has done and who he did it against and how important he was in terms of building the sport, I mean, just an absolute honor. What a privilege. Very fun day. Okay, later in the program, we're going to be joined by George Lockhart, the nutritionist extraordinaire, who will be sharing some very interesting news with us. So I do suggest you stick around for that. Cynthia Calvillo, who is one of the top strawweights in the world, she will join us as well. To talk about her future. She also has some news to share. We're also going to be joined by Arjun Buller, who was successful on Saturday in Ottawa. He defeated Juan Adams, but his contract is up, and he's got some things in the works, some interesting things. I alluded to one of those things in my 21 Thoughts column that just came out on ESPN.com earlier today. And at the top of the hour, we're going to be joined by Rory McDonald. You may have been following that story over the past week or so, his post-fight comments after the John Fitch fight, and also on Tuesday he came out and officially told us that he will not be retiring. He will be fighting Neiman Gracie, and that fight is going to take place June 14th. So I had a lot of thoughts about all of that, and I'm curious to hear from Roy McDonald, get his thoughts on where he stands, how he feels about his career, and whatnot. I didn't mention it at the top because we wanted to get to Ben Askren. Of course, we're coming off the UFC Ottawa event this past Saturday. Donald Cerrone, successful against Ally Quinta. What a fight. What a performance from Donald Cerrone. He is undefeated still since becoming a dad. 3-0. You're looking at the results right over there. The biggest story, of course, the main event, Cerrone, Ally Quinta. And it was fairly, I mean, by the time the fight was over, we all knew who won. We all knew that Cerrone won. I have so much respect for Ally Quinta for the damage he took, for refusing to quit, for never backing down. But in the end, that was a Cerrone fight, and he has just looked incredible since coming down to 155 from 170. His fight against Alex Hernandez was phenomenal in January, and his fight on Saturday was phenomenal. And so it leads us to start questioning where he is in the division. And for the first time, he is talking about fighting for the belt. He is talking about wanting to be a champion. I remember throughout the majority of his career, we would ask him about the belt. We would ask him about, you know, where he stands in the division. He would say, I just want to fight. I just want to get paid. I talked about this in my column today. I remember talking to him after he beat Dennis Seaver, and he improved to 4-0 in the UFC. We talked to him about the belt. He's like, I just want to fight one more time this year. I just want to get more money. I just want to be active. I don't really care about the belt. And I remember thinking, like, wow, this doesn't make any sense. No one talks about the belt that way. Everyone wants to be a champion. Well, now he's starting to evolve, and I think it's very much because he is a dad, and I think because of the fact that he finally became a father, and now he's fighting for someone else, in a weird way. Like, I know to maybe a non-parent, you might think, like, oh, he's being selfish now, like, he just cares about the belt. In fact, him talking about the belt and him wanting to be a champion so bad makes me think that he is more unselfish than ever. It makes me think that Donald Cerrone is now starting to not just think about himself, but think about his son. And he wants to tell his son, I am a champion. He wants to show his son the belt. He wants to show him that he actually accomplished, you know, the greatest thing that an MMA fighter can accomplish at this point, and that is becoming a UFC champion. And so it's actually a beautiful thing to watch, because we are seeing a man evolve in front of our eyes, and perhaps a little different than the Roy McDonald story. We're actually seeing him sort of come to the realization that, hey, I'm the winningest fighter in UFC history. At this point, I'll probably go down if I don't win the title as the greatest fighter to never win a belt. Last week I talked about Jacare, the greatest fighter to never fight for a belt. Well, Cerrone would be the greatest fighter to never win a belt if it does go that way. And it's cool to see him, you know, become singularly focused and say to the world, no, I do want a title shot. I do want to become a champion. And this is very different than what we heard from him in the past. And I really respect it. And I think it's really cool to hear. Where he fits in that division is a totally different story, because I don't think he is going to get a title shot next. Of course, we know that Khabib Nurmagomedov is most likely going to return in September. If all works out, it will be in Abu Dhabi, and what a great scene that will be. And the fight that will probably happen is Dustin Poirier. Cerrone talked about Conor McGregor, and that is certainly a fight that is worth putting together. It's certainly a fight that makes sense from a draw standpoint, from a box office standpoint. I won't harp on the call. This time, it was a little less, like, laissez-faire.
Looks like you earned yourself another bounty.
It almost seemed
like
the title was more important than Conor, but Conor was a nice, you know, plan B, if you will. I'm not gonna I'm not gonna dissect that with a fine-tooth comb anymore. I said my piece, and again, I said it out of love. I said it because I was looking out for the guy. I said it because he's the winningest fighter in UFC history, and he deserves to believe that and tell the world that. And so, again, I'll just say that one last time. But it seems, if I was in charge, I would do the Khabib-Poirier fight, because I think you have to do the Poirier fight for Khabib next. And I also think that the best fight to make is Tony Ferguson versus Conor McGregor for Conor McGregor. Tony Ferguson, as I reported earlier, is in Las Vegas, actually, right now. And he's going to meet with the UFC brass in a matter of moments. And then I would do Justin Gaethje versus Donald Cerrone. That's the fight that I think would be incredible from a stylistic standpoint. And I also think that, just in terms of ranking and who's next and whatnot, it's the fight that makes the most sense. So we'll see what happens there with Cerrone, with Ferguson, with Conor. There's a lot going on. But in my opinion, the big story of this past week was the fact that Brock Lesnar said, "Peace, I'm out of here. I'm not fighting. I was stringing you guys along for the last 10 or so months. I'm out." And in comes Stipe Miocic, and it appears as though what they want is Stipe versus DC2. Well, we have not talked to Daniel Cormier in 2019. Could you believe it? He's always been so bad, but he hasn't been on the show since we moved here. And so I had to bother him and get him on the program, and he's kind enough to join us. So we'll keep this wrestling royalty thing going on here. We went from Askren to Couture to now Cormier on the program. Joining us on the phone, the one and only, the UFC heavyweight champion, Daniel DC Cormier. Daniel, how are you?
What's up, Ariel? How you doing, bud?
It's good to talk to you. It's been a while.
It's been a minute. I mean, it's been a minute. You got a new studio. You got everything. It's very odd that I have not been on. I thought you cut me off, but good to see you invited me back.
Well, I felt like I was bothering you a little bit towards the end of the year. It felt like it was like too many asks, even though I will maintain that they were all very relevant. You were just in the news a lot in the fourth quarter of 2018. But I think it's been good that we had this separation. I'm so happy that you're back on. Like I said, we have a lot to talk about. So let's start with what happened last week. Are you disappointed? Are you ultimately upset that the Brock Lesnar fight did not come to fruition?
With this whole Brock Lesnar thing, it was... When Stipe and I's fight got announced, Stipe and I both were pretty knowledgeable of the idea that whoever won was probably going to get the fight left. And I imagine he was going to do the same thing that I did. I mean, obviously, he wouldn't have waited. He waited, and he lost, So I got excited, as a fan of Brock, and as a guy that's known Brock for a long time. Brock and I have a story. Whenever we were both junior college, he was the heavyweight. I was 97-pounder, and people always wonder who would win. Minnesota, Oklahoma State. So there's a lot of history in terms of why I wanted to compete against him. But when it didn't happen, you just kind of move on to the next thing, and this is what it is. It was a little disappointing in the sense that I would have loved to compete against him. It's a big fight, big moment, but I've always been a guy that just kind of does what's up next.
To the best of your knowledge, why didn't it come to fruition?
I don't know. I think when we get these fights, there's a lot of negotiations. There are a lot of things that need to be discussed and hammered out. I don't know if Brock was able to come to terms with the UFC. I just don't know. I'm sure he'll bounce back. He always seems to land on his feet. So I just know that I got a call saying that Brock is going to be done fighting. And, what do you want to do next?
Do you believe that he is done?
I think that Brock's a competitor. And I do believe that if the right opportunity presents itself for him, he would do it. I mean, look, the guy's a fighter, man. Everybody kind of shoots on Brock Lesnar and talks that this guy can't fight, but he's a fighter and he's a competitor. And he likes money. So for the right amount of money and the right opportunity, I'm sure Brock Lesnar could be convinced to come back.
So when you got the call and you were told that, Brock is out of the picture, what do you want to do next? What did you say?
From the moment me and Brock were in the octagon and we were shoving and we had the WrestleMania moment. Right afterwards, they said, Brock, Stipe Miocic had defended this belt all these times and he was this, he was that, he would call him the greatest heavyweight. I said, listen, and I've really stood it. I've said it from day one and I've always stood firm in that belief. And when Brock wasn't fighting, that was the conversation we had. I said, I've always said I'd fight Stipe again if Lesnar couldn't fight. So I was like, let's fight Stipe.
Okay, so they announced that the Stipe fight is happening. From your perspective, is it official?
Well, until when the pen goes to paper, then it's a official, but a lot of the terms now have been discussed. I got to speak with him this morning, and you know, we're pretty set to go. You know, my wife has, look, man, my wife has a few concerns about, you know, the fight and just things, normal things. You know, like last time I was in Anaheim, I got knocked out. You know, so she's like, do we really want to go back to Anaheim? You know, those little things that are kind of in her head, but I think we're well on our way.
Okay, but it's not a done deal as far as you're concerned.
I just have to sign the bout agreement. I have it now. I have all my stuff. The terms are good. It just, yeah. I'm sure it's gonna happen. The fight's gonna happen.
Okay. Do you have concerns about fighting in Anaheim again? Like you said, the place where you last, you know, the last time you were there, you got knocked out. Do you have weird feelings, weird thoughts about that?
Louisiana, you know, so voodoo is real. I try to believe in my preparation. You know, as long as I'm prepared,
safe,
I feel like I'm good.
Detected.
I take a different approach to those things. You know, like for me, it's like, well, I lost there last time. I want to go and change my memories of Anaheim by winning there. You know, and I lost in Las Vegas. You know, 4 months later, I was back winning the UFC championship. So I just don't like to cut off a place based on being unsuccessful in a competition. I'd rather go and try to make it better.
For you, going from, you know, the challenge of fighting Brock to the challenge of fighting a guy you knocked out a year ago, like, does it feel the same? Like, does it feel like, you know, I need to get motivated for this? I need to get up for it? I already conquered this mountain.
I'm going to be motivated for the fight. That's one thing that I will always do. I'm very disciplined in my preparation for these competitions. I really am. But my thing is, I'll fight again. You know, I don't know how I can beat him better. I don't know how I can beat him better than I beat him last time.
Look how much.
But to me, it's just about getting the victory. If I won a decision this time, I won a decision. It doesn't matter. I just know that the expectation from the people outside, it's tough to top the way I did it last time. That was just such a special moment, you know, to knock out the longest reigning heavyweight champion of all time. Within one round, it was truly phenomenal. But I intend on beating him again. You know, I do believe that just stylistically, and I feel like as the fight was going on, I was starting to get his timing. I was starting to kind of feel him, and I just feel that I'm a better mixed martial artist than Stipe.
If you had your druthers, were there any other candidates that were of interest, guys you haven't fought, you know, the Ngannous of the world, people like that, or, you know, if it wasn't going to be Brock Lesnar, did it have to be Stipe?
It had to be him. Okay. You know, it had to be him because of what he had done prior. I mean, you can't ignore what this guy has done in the heavyweight division, you know, defending that belt all those times and winning in the ways that he did, and you know, Stipe has always had a reputation for being such a good guy, you know, a guy that does a lot of things positively, not only in his community, but just for mixed martial arts, you know, and I knew that if I wasn't going to fight Brock, it was going to have to be him, and he deserved that. Now, when we were on The Ultimate Fighter, you know, there was a lot of sunshine and rainbows between us. You know, we seemed as if we might be friends. Like, now I have a little bit of a different, I have a little bit of a different approach to our relationship this time. I don't necessarily feel, I did not like the approach that he took and just kind of waiting. I think he's so good that even if he would have fought over the course of this year, he still would be in the same position. So, I don't necessarily feel that I have to be nice to him anymore.
That was actually my next question, because it did seem like you guys were chummy going into the first fight. He put out that video with his kid and said that, you know, I would have done the same for you. Do you feel like he came across as a little entitled?
For sure. Absolutely. I felt the whole time I said he was a bit entitled. You know, like, you know, man, it would have been different if we did not understand. You know, these are conversations we had with the company. Like, yo, when are you guys going to get to fight Brock Lesnar? And he was just as happy as I was. You know, so to make it seem as though I was doing something wrong after I was the one that won the fight, I just felt like it just was unfair a little bit. You know, and then just like, you know, every now and again, he posts a picture of him, like, punching me or something. I'm like, yo, what? You punched me, okay? We fought. Of course you punched me. He's like, now I'm going to show you why I belong in the title fight. And there's a picture of him just punching me. We had a fight. Of course you have pictures of you punching me. There were, like, millions of people there. Like, they all, millions of people watched it. Like, they saw you punch me. I put the damn picture up of you punching me and acting like I'm wronging you or something. Like, I'm not wronging this guy. Like, I'm doing, and doing exactly what we were told to do after our first fight. That's it. Like, that's it. And, yeah, it felt entitled. I mean, when Jones beat me the first time, I immediately scheduled another fight and said, I'm going to go fight Ryan Bader and try to figure out how I get back there. Right?
Right.
And then he had the thing happen and I had to fight Rumble for the belt. Okay? Then when Jones beat me in July, I said, okay, I'm going to take some time. But how do I get back? Do I go to heavyweight? Like, how do I earn another fight with this guy? That's all I can think about. And then the stuff happened 3 weeks later, and I got the belt back, and I said, okay, I need to finish thing enough times to get back to fighting him. That was always my thought, my intention, and that was the approach I took. So for me, I knew how bad I wanted to fight him again, so I knew I was willing to do anything, not just sit there and wait for the whole time about not getting exactly what you wanted.
And so for the last two or so years, you told us, even though I said I didn't necessarily believe you, you stuck to your guns. You said, I'm going to retire when I turn 40. By the time I turn 40, I will be done.
Yep.
Turned 40 in March. Happy
I know it
birthday.
Sucked. Yep.
And you were fighting in August. And so
yeah.
Does that mean this whole thing has been blown up, or will this be your retirement fight?
You know, I think we have to take these things one at a time at this point. You know, like, I'm not necessarily saying I'm going to fight 3-4 times. I think for me, it would need to be something very intriguing. I always wanted that one more fight, though, Ariel. I always wanted that one more fight. And I haven't even told anybody this. Like, the reason I didn't fight in March was because I had back surgery in December. Like, when I was about to fight Derek Lewis, and I was telling you guys all how I sneezed, and I was like, my back was so jacked, I didn't know what was going on.
Right.
It was so bad that about a week later, 2 weeks later, I started having pain going down my hip. So I was like, yo, what's going on with my hip? What's going on with my hip? What's going on with my hip? And I would travel, and then right around Christmas, I went to Milwaukee for that last Fox show, because I was like, I have to do it. My last time to work for Fox, even though my hip was bothering me. And then Kane was going to fight Ngannou, so I went in to try to help him. And, I mean, I barely did anything. My back was bothering me so bad, the next morning I couldn't even walk. It was like I had a disc that was bulging out of my back. It was sitting on my sciatic nerve. It was out 2 inches out of the chamber that holds the disc in.
Whoa.
2 inches the disc was out. I couldn't even walk. I was like, Deron Wynn had to actually carry me out of my house into my truck to take me all around to see doctors because my wife was having to deal with my children. You know, I was like, yeah, it was bad. That's why I haven't fought. Like, I would have fought in March if I was healthy, but I really probably should not have fought Derek Lewis. I was so hurt, but the UFC staff, they massaged me and made me feel well enough to where on that day I was able to compete, and then as time went on, I guess it was just getting worse. I had back surgery, so
wow. So
that's why.
When did you have the surgery?
December 22nd, I had a surgery on my back. Yeah, I had surgery. I didn't tell anybody this.
Yeah.
Why?
How'd you keep the secret?
Just because I didn't tell everybody. I mean, I'm just sitting there, like, everybody's talking to me. I'm like, I'm afraid of Stipe, and why am I not fighting this dude? Whole time, I'm just, like, laid up on my back, like, you guys are so stupid. Like, I'm like, what if I ever been afraid to fight somebody? I couldn't physically do it. So, now that I'm back healthy and I'm able to train and I feel good, look, man, I've got a great surgeon. You know, Dr. Carl Stidham in the Bay Area has fixed my hand. He's dealt with he found the perfect back surgeon for my back. And I feel better than I have in years. I thought my back was just bad because I wrestled my whole life. But obviously that was way more to it. I got the perfect guy to fix my back, and now I feel even better than I did 2 years ago.
Wow, and any concern, like, so you feel okay now? Did they tell you when they did the surgery that you shouldn't fight anymore, that this should be it? What would
no, 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 no.
Okay.
It wasn't that bad, right? See, I was still trying to do March 2nd. I was like, can I do March 2nd? I was like, can I do March 2nd when I have back surgery? And he goes, that's about 10 weeks away, 11 weeks. He goes, you're going to be out for about 6 weeks. He goes, if you can do a 5-week training camp, said, that's on you. And I was like, nope, can't do it. You know, I was just, it was just too bad. So, yeah, I needed to get that fixed. This is something that I've been dealing with my whole life. You know, I've had a lot of injuries. I've had a 25-year combat career. So, it was time for me to go and get that fixed. I got it fixed. And I'm telling you, man, today I feel better than I did 2-3 years ago.
Wow. Okay. So that explains a lot about why you didn't fight. So when I ask you the question, by the time you sort of left the door open here, and Dana White has repeatedly said there's 3 fights left for you, potentially. There's Brock, there's Stipe, and there's John. You knew I was going to ask you about this, but it seems like you're leaving the door open for that potential trilogy fight.
Yeah, you know, man, look, man, it's all I want. You know, I think when I fight Jones, I think that I feel most complete when I'm preparing for a competition against that guy. Because it makes me train harder. It makes me train smarter. I do everything right in preparation. And I believe that if I do stick around, that would be the fight that I would do it for. And it would be at 205 pounds because I need to go and get that back from him.
Why? Because you feel like it's not the same because he beat you twice there. You have to do it at 205?
That's exactly why. You know, I don't need the decks stacked in my favor. My whole life I've overcome odds, right? I've faced uphill battle after uphill battle my entire life, and I've always been able to get through it. You know, this is one of the only things that I've not been able to conquer it. And I need to go do it. I have to get it right, and I have to get it right on the same terms. So there's a fight out there. We'll be him and I, and it'll be at 205 pounds.
So are you saying that this is what you want, that after Stipe, this is what you're going to go after?
I don't know. You know, again, I have to take everything one day at a time. Like I, you know, I was so stern in the fact that I was done. You know, and Ariel, I don't need to fight anymore for the same financial reason most people fight for security, for direction. I have all that. You know, I have enough money. You know, I have jobs on top of jobs to keep me busy after I'm done. And I got my wrestling teams. I've got the high school team. I've got so many things going that I don't need this just to need it. You know, so if I walk away from this thing, I'm fine. I just need to take it one at a time. I have to focus on Stipe. Stipe's too good for me to fight John Jones next. That's ridiculous. Then I'll lose. And then nothing's on the team. Then people are showing me the door, right? I can be one of the very few guys that gets to make the determination when he wants to walk away if I win this fight. And walk away at the top of the game.
But would it be fair to say that there's only two, like Dana is correct, there are only two left?
There's only two fights out there for me. You know, there's a Miocic rematch and there's a Jones fight if there is a fight.
Okay.
I just don't anticipate just fighting anybody at this point.
Right. And would it be fair to say during your time off, like you have sort of come to the realization that maybe you will feel a little bit incomplete if you don't go after Jones one more time? Because that's what it sounds like based on what you're saying. I have not heard you say this. And so I'm a little bit taken aback by it because I thought that you were going to tell me, stop asking me about it, I'm done. And you threw me a curveball here, so I'm surprised to hear you say that, to be honest.
No, it's just competitively. You know, like competitively, if you want to make everything right competitively, then you go get back the one that you lost. That's nothing new. I've always said that. You know, like if I want to make everything complete, this is the one that I have to get back. It's the only guy that's beaten me. But if I don't, trust me, like I can be fine. I could be fine, but I'm just fiercely competitive. It's just who I am, and it's allowed me to be who I am today. So when I say if there is another fight after this one, then it would have to be that one. That's it.
Has the surgery maybe extended your career a little bit? Like, you feel so good? Are you starting to rethink, like, maybe I got 2 more years left in me?
I feel like it's helped me because of all the pain I was in. I mean, Chris Camacho used to actually sit there and he'd have to just be like stretching me after I was done, you know, like, but now I don't have to do that. I can stretch myself. I can be good and feel good. You know, before, man, I was in immense pain. Like I'd wake up in the morning, just walking, like leaned over at the waist. My back was just that bad. But, now I feel fine.
Wow. When you watch John, especially the last fight, do you say to yourself, man, come on, this isn't the same John Jones. I got to go after him one more. Like, did that give you motivation too?
You know how I tell you that I believe Stipe Miocic is going to be better this time. He'll be really motivated.
Right.
Because I know how motivated I was to fight Jones the second time after he beat.
Right.
I know how difficult this fight is going to be for me. And you watch Jones against a guy like,
Anthony Smith fought last.
Anthony Smith, yeah. And then the next guy is fighting. July 20, whatever it was, 2017. Those are the two best versions that I've ever been in my career because I know how motivated I was to win those fights. I don't know if I've ever been better, and he's been able to solve that puzzle. So if I was to fight him again, I would need to be even better than I was back then.
You still think about that second fight a lot?
I do a little bit every now and again because I feel like I just did not stay focused. You know, I was fighting and, you know, he was hitting me and we're going back and forth. And when I was laser focused, right, I'm checking kicks, I'm countering, we're landing, we go 1-1 into the third round in terms of judging. And by the end of the second round, I'm like, oh, trash. And I'm just like, I should have just stayed focused. I've never done that. I'm not a guy that is in there talking to people and stuff.
No.
I'm laser focused. I know what I'm trying to accomplish, and I need to stay in that. And I feel like by not being 100% zoned in as I should have been, it cost me ultimately.
Do you think that he, if offered, would accept the fight?
He was going back
and forth, like, I've done it already. But then when he beat Alex, he was like, hey, do you see where I'm at?
There's no question he would.
Right.
There's no question he would.
Yeah.
It's
even though, as a competitor, you want to do it, and also to make the most money together. If you like money, we make the most money together. He would definitely I don't know if you should always like believe everything he says at face value. This guy's green and you're like, okay. Are you one of those guys?
No, I'm not.
You can't always just take everything he says at face value.
I do take the odds makers at face value, and they say that you're a slight favorite heading into the rematch. If you were an odds maker, Daniel, what would you say the odds are on you fighting Jones a third time? You see what I did there? See how I did that?
I'm not fighting Jones. Fight Stipe Miocic. That's the focus.
Okay.
I still think Stipe should be the favorite. He was the favorite last time.
What? This is the first lie you told in this
interview. See what I did there? You're lying to me. I'll lie to your ass.
Oh, my God. You still think Stipe should be the favorite. Right. I don't believe that for a second. You're going to Brazil, right? When are you going to Brazil?
Yes, I am.
When?
I'm going to Brazil on Wednesday.
I can't believe you go to international pay-per-views. I thought you were too big time for that.
It's the first one. I haven't been to an international one for a long time. It's my job, man. I've got to do what I am asked to do. So I'm going to go and call that great fight. It's a great fight. You know, I'm going to go watch Rose Namajunas defend their title on there. I get to watch Anderson Silva compete again. How good is this Volkanovski? You know, he gets to fight the GOAT Naldo. It's going to be great. I cannot wait to go down there. It's a fantastic card. Why wouldn't I want to go to Brazil?
There needs to be a clause in your contract, in the UFC's contract with Rose, that every time she fights, you have to be there. Like, you're like JR to Stone Cold. You have to be there to say Thug Rose when she gets done.
Let me tell you something, man. You know, I'm not one to pat myself on my back. That was one of the best calls in mixed martial arts history. You know, it's just, when you just kind of like, I was at a loss for words, so all I could say was Thug Rose. This was not planned. Some moments are so big that it just kind of happens. You know, and I was talking about a guy's commentary the other day on boxing, and they said, a couple fans were like, all you do is praise Thug Rose. Like, that's so stupid. I'm like, you know, if it's so stupid, why? they played on all the promos. I'm doing something right. There's people keep backing up the truck and my house is funny. So you cannot like someone. I am doing something right. Like, I'm doing something right. You may have hated the Thug Bros, but more people like you and obviously the UFC, they like it. They like the looseness I have whenever I call fights.
All right, so August 17th is your return to action. You're calling the action this Saturday. I hope they give you a stacked card. I hope they throw a couple of those big names on there, right? I mean, you kind of have to carry the weight of the promotion for MSG. I hope they give you some big names.
Man, I'm telling you, I need a big fight card because some guys get great fight cards. You know, I want one of those too. Steve and I deserve it. Yep. We deserve it, you know? This is going to be a fantastic fight, Ariel. This is going to be a fantastic fight. I know how hard he's going to beat again, but I'm going to prepare for it. And mentally, I'm as ready to fight as I've been in a long time. So
wow.
This little break was nice for me.
You've given us a lot to chew on here, DC. This has been something else. I'm sort of...
That's what happens when you don't talk for 4 or 5 months.
I'm sort of out of breath here. I mean, you've just given me a lot to consider. And, of course, I want to... Yes?
How about one more thing?
Okay.
You want one more thing?
Yes, please.
You do?
Yes, I would love it.
Okay, so your little new home, ESPN?
Yes.
I've got a new show there, too.
Really?
So be on the lookout. Yes, I've got a new show there, and this is the, I can't give you 100%, but I will tell you, I've got a new show there.
Okay.
And listen, only people that host this show are some of the greatest athletes in their choosing or given sports.
Wow.
No one else gets to host it. Only my name, when this show starts, will be listed among some of the greatest sports athletes the world has ever seen.
Whoa.
There you go.
That's it? ESPN. You can't tell us the whole thing?
That's it. No, I can't tell you the whole thing. I
just,
a
taste? Can I ask?
You can have fun with yourself once I get off the phone.
Okay, because I feel like the way you, like the path that you took me down, I feel like I know it, but I don't want to get you in trouble.
I won't get in trouble, but I like to give. I just want to give you a little taste, you know, like a little small taste.
You're like Chris Paul out there against the Warriors, dropping dimes left and right. You know what I'm saying? Game 4 coming up, baby. Let's go.
Let's go,
Clutch City.
Let's go.
Come on.
Oh, Clutch City.
Damn.
Come on, man. Let's go.
DC.
I gave you a little bit, though.
That was something.
I don't think you have to. If you go and you just look, you're so good at taking
my inventory.
I'm pretty sure
I'm happy to have made a deal.
Have you guys? Yes.
Nice talking to you.
You're the man, DC. Thank you so much. What a pleasure.
All right.
He is back. It sounds like he is back. August 17th. His back is feeling good. He had surgery on it. Who knew? Back in December. He's not fighting Brock Lesnar. But he's fighting Stipe Miocic. And it sounds like he might stick around a little longer and fight John Jones. There was a lot there. Can I make a guess? I'm going to make a guess. That's my guess. But it's just between us. DC's on his way to Rio, UFC 237, this weekend. Can I get the music? Can I get the dong? There it is. There's that music I love. Rose Namajunas. Just got Drudge. I actually just got an email about this. I believe now you can buy the pay-per-views on the app. Is that true, Voice of God? Is that true?
That is correct.
That is correct. There she is.
On the app.
Who needs Corporate Jake? Get him out of here. Voice of God taking over. The takeover. It's the Voice of God. I have to get a catchy nickname for Grip back there. I don't have one yet. I'm working on that. A lot going on. Anyway, you can buy the pay-per-views on the app. So that's big. Mazel tov to everyone involved. Rose Namajunas, Jessica Andrade, Alex Volkanovski against Jose Aldo. I just saw a picture of Jose Aldo. He looks phenomenal. And also, Jared Cannonier. It's all very exciting stuff. All right, speaking of exciting, I am very excited to talk to our next guest. I wanted to talk to him last week, but of course wanted to give him some space, some time. He respectfully declined, but he is so kind enough to join us this week. Let's not waste any more time. Let's say hello to the Bellator welterweight champion. There he is, smiling. So happy, Rory McDonald. How are you?
Doing good. How are you?
I'm doing great, Rory. Wow, we've been talking a lot about you, as you can imagine, over the past week or so. So I really appreciate you doing this. Let me just ask a very simple question, and it's one that I don't really like asking in interviews, but I feel like it's apropos. How are you doing? How are you feeling 9 days removed from your fight against John Fitch?
I'm feeling good. Thanks for asking.
Okay. Physically, mentally, you're feeling okay?
Yeah, a lot better. Obviously, in my post-fight interview, I seemed a little confused about what was going on, but after reflecting, after a couple of days, I have a better understanding going forward of my purpose and drive in the sport now, so feeling good.
Were you surprised at the reaction that those comments generated?
Yeah, maybe a little, that I got so much attention over it. I don't know, I was just speaking from the heart in the moment. I wasn't really thinking too far ahead. I was just talking as if I was talking to only John. And that's it.
And that has sort of been, I think, something that fans have come to love and respect from you, that you keep it real. You're not very fake. You're an authentic fighter, if you will, when it comes to your comments. But you mentioned the word... Oh, did we lose you? We may have lost him. Did we lose him? Yes, we did. Okay, we'll get him back. But I wanted to ask him about something he just said.
Object of interest detected.
When he returns, we'll reconnect with Roy McDonald in a matter of moments. In case you missed it last week, he fought to a majority draw against John Fitch in San Jose in Bellator. He's going to return to action. He posted this on social media. I believe it was Tuesday afternoon that he is going to return on June 14th to fight Neiman Gracie in the next round of the Bellator Welterweight Grand Prix semifinals. The other bracket actually will play out this Saturday just outside of Chicago as Douglas Lima, the former champion, meets Michael Venom Page. I do believe we have Rory back. Is he there? There he is. Hey, Rory. You said something in your previous answer that I just wanted to ask you about. You said that you felt confused. What did you feel confused about?
Well, I felt like I was unsure of, like, the emotions I was feeling in the fight. So, I don't know if you read my statement after the fight, a couple of days after the fight.
Yep.
But, you know, for the longest time, I fought with a certain anger inside of me. So, it was kind of like a release, you know. I felt good to fight, to do damage, and, like, it made me feel better about myself. In some kind of a way. And lately, because of, you know, my new relationship with Jesus Christ, and I just don't feel that that hurt in my heart or that pain that it used to drive me. I have new life, so, and peace in my heart, and I don't really have that anger that used to drive me. So finding, like, it's kind of weird to go into a fight and not go through the same emotions that I may have used to or I'm used to feeling. So
supply
I guess
drop.
I was just caught up thinking about
Seal. Cover me
why
that
I was
feeling
now. Like this. What
are you doing here? Orders now?
So I was just not sure what to do.
This is something that I feel like you've been feeling for a little bit, right? This isn't a new phenomenon.
Serious trauma.
This particular one is probably the most dramatic.
Agent incapacitated.
Because as
Agent
I grow closer
deceased.
To God and my relationship deepens and the changes are taking place, as I'm progressing, it's becoming more evident. As I'm letting go of my old life and you know, walking a new life, I feel it's the change more.
Did you ever have moments in the fight where you were thinking to yourself, like, I don't really want to be here, I'm not really feeling this, I wish this would just end?
No, not at all. Like, I wasn't, like, stressed out. I was just more just thinking in my head about how he was feeling.
Hostiles.
I wasn't stressed out about
drop.
The fight. In fact, I was taking a lot of breaks just to kind of think.
Incoming hostiles
just,
detected.
Like, worry about what I was doing in the cage.
Detecting additional hostile contacts.
Yeah.
I remember when we spoke.
Hostiles are open.
After the
supply drop.
Before the fight and obviously after the Musasi fight, and you said that, you know, you didn't really feel like yourself in there against Musasi, you could pull the trigger.
Immediate medical assistance needed.
Somewhat, but a little different. So, in the Musasi fight, I feel like it was due to mostly preparation and focus. Whereas with this fight, I was very prepared. It was mostly just being caught up with the, what I was going through in the cage, and, where I was gonna move forward, and, you know, what's my, you know, what my purpose was as a fighter now, so,
Agent down. that score your group?
I mean, it was close. In my opinion, I feel like I won the fight, but I gave him some rounds with successfully control, that's for sure.
Another agent is now in your group.
I feel like you won the fight, even on the scorecards. I feel like I won, but as far as judging the fight on the whole, I mean, I won the fight.
When you went to the back, what was that scene like? Because I think you said your comments, the MMA world is buzzing over them. But you're the one, you're the one who said that you're going to the back end. I was thinking, like, gosh, I wonder what the Bellator officials are going to say to this. Like, I appreciate this, obviously, but I'm not the one paying you, right? I'm not the one paying you, man. So what was the mood like back then?
An agent is no longer in your group.
I think they were pretty concerned. They didn't know if I was going to, like, hang up the gloves. I think everybody's kind of hanging on the edge. Like, what am I saying there? Like, I didn't really make a decisive statement. You know, I was just going to keep a very confusing statement, so even me, I didn't know what it all meant at the time, so I needed time to reflect. But after only a day or two, I've been praying about it, asking God to help me in understanding what I'm supposed to do moving forward. God answered my prayers very fast, and I know that I still have more time here as a fighter. And I'm going to use this platform and fight for this platform to do my best to, represent my faith and, to talk about how good God is and be an example of that for people. And hopefully, some people can find inspiration and find the Lord that way, if possible, until the next door opens.
When you walked out of the cage last Saturday, did you think there was a chance that was your last fight?
Yeah, because I was a little confused. I didn't understand what was going on. So, I was unsure, yeah.
Was it just a matter of you needing some more time, or did you have a particular conversation with someone that allowed you to decide that, okay, I'm going to continue?
Well, I mean, there were a couple, like, key people that I talked to that I trusted, that I respect, and that helped have just a good conversation about what I'm going through that, help make the decision a little more clear, but I do feel just through thinking and reflection, I came up with it up on my own through God.
Who did you speak to?
Obviously my wife and my pastor were probably the two key people that I feel that were very helpful in this situation.
My understanding is that your pastor attended the fight, correct?
Well, he's not my pastor, but he is he's an evangelist, he's a brother of one of the pastors at my church, so we're friends through the church community, I guess.
The reason for bringing it up was I was wondering if that was the first time that he or someone like that came to one of your fights.
Yeah, I think so.
And do you feel like there's sort of like a tug and pull between, what you do for a living, cage fighting and things like that, and maybe the religious beliefs? Is that the struggle that you're having right now?
No, because I'm not conflicted about being a Christian and fighting.
Okay.
It was more about moving forward in my role for what I'm going to do for God,
Incoming at this request.
What I was saying about my emotions inside the cage. So what my passions, what my reasons are for fighting, what drives me to do a good job, to push through the hard times, you need something to fuel your fire. And I guess that fight was kind of crossing a bridge between my old self and new self as a mixed martial artist. Walking over that bridge, during that fight, some mixed emotions, confusion about what was happening, but after some reflection I feel I got to start myself going forward, and I won't be second guessing myself in there. When I fight Demon, I have it in my heart and in my head what I want to do and what I need to do as a competitor.
You say those words, just trying to figure out, again, I hate to scrutinize. honesty because it's so refreshing, but also it, you know, it leads people to start talking about your past and some of the fights that you've been in and the Robbie Lawler fight and things like that and concussions and CT. Are you at all concerned that any of this has to do with your brain, with the wars that you've been in?
I honestly feel very healthy. I mean, I'm more clear-headed now than I ever have been.
Man, more engaged.
I'm not worried about brain damage.
Okay. Did you see a lot of people say he took your soul? I'm sure you see this stuff as well.
Detonated gear detected.
I'm just curious if you felt like any of that came into play. It is a very quick turnaround. You are returning in a little over a month, June 14th. Is there any part of you that wanted to just take a little more time off?
Reflection and just relaxing. I'm trying to train hard and get back in there. I still have my soul.
Okay. And when you say that you're having conversations with God, what are those like?
Well, I'm not sure. I explained it properly. I was just kind of like letting things flow out, but I was examining how I was feeling, what I was going through, and just kind of thinking deeply, rather than just being in the fight. I wasn't necessarily in prayer or anything like that, but I was, you know, obviously there was thoughts about, you know,
detecting additional hostile contacts.
Why am I feeling this way? And, you know, obviously my relationship with God is a big part of the way I think. So,
how did you become so religious?
I started going to church with my wife when we first met, and just hearing the word of God spoken started just taking root in me, and I kept going, and started taking more of an interest in my relationship with God and how to make myself right with God and reading the Bible and just learning more. And I gave my life to Jesus and started a new life.
How long ago was that?
Well, just after I first met my wife. Would have been like 2016.
Okay.
But I mean, I don't think I really like gave my life over to like the summer of 2017 is when I decided to be baptized. And
prior to, you know, meeting your wife and 2016, you were not religious at all?
I had some moments. I was raised Catholic, but I never really had a relationship with Jesus. I didn't really understand that. I just kind of was told stories and went to church once in a while, but didn't really understand in depth of what it meant to be, you know, a Christian and what that meant. But in time, after like hearing the word spoken and reading the Bible and studying that, just growing day by day, I started to understand.
Obviously, you're a part of this tournament, and there's just two fights left.
Detecting contaminated gear.
$1 million. Is there a chance you go through the tournament, it all goes well,
landmark
and then you call
has
it
been cleared. Landmark spotted.
I don't think so.
Okay. You're gonna keep going. So you went from walking out of the cage in San Jose 9 days ago to thinking you might retire to now it's wide open. There's no end in sight.
Yeah, I mean obviously this career is going to end at some point, but I don't see it ending after this tournament.
Okay, and you haven't put like any sort of age or time frame to when you want to stop?
No, whenever the next door opens in my life, I'll know the time.
Is there any part of you that is scared or concerned that those feelings will come back in the Gracie fight?
No, I'm not worried at all.
Okay. I said last week that I was a little disappointed in his comments after your fight, saying that he was like, oh, I don't believe. He said he didn't believe what you were saying.
on the way.
I would like to see the fighters support each other a little more. I was wondering if you heard or read any of those comments and were disappointed or bothered by them at all, the way he was reacting to what you said in the cage.
I'm not sure if I heard everything. I think he said that he didn't believe me, that I didn't want to hurt him because he seen me really trying to hurt him. And to a degree, I wanted to fight after, and I was going for the knockout several times. And then other times I was kind of laying back and kind of thinking rather than just doing my job and attacking. But I don't think that's what it was. I don't think it was my heart to hurt him. I think it was more of just the tug of war of emotions of being my old resistance fight and, you know, who I am now in Christ.
Again, I really appreciate you opening up the way you did in the cage now in that statement. I'm happy to hear that you're okay, Rory, that you feel good with how everything has played out, that you're going to continue. You've always been great, and I think that anyone who criticizes your comments, I know in our day and age, that people get uncomfortable when religion is brought up in sports and things like that, but I give you a lot of credit for not caring about what people think and just saying what's on your mind, what's in your heart as well. So thank you very much for doing this. Congrats on a great fight. Good luck, June 14th. As always, great to talk to you, and it's nice to see Montreal, a little bit of Montreal in the background over there.
Yeah, thanks, Ariel. Nice to talk to you.
All right, there he is. One and only Warren McDonald. A very special person, a very special fighter in this game, just 29 years young, turning 30 in July, so a month or so after his fight against Neiman Gracie. And so there you have it. We'll take his word for it. He is going to continue. He wants to keep fighting. He feels good. He was a little confused, but he's going to keep on going. Fascinating stuff there from Rory McDonald. All right, let's go from one British Columbia fighter to another. He was the only Canadian fighter to beat an American this past Saturday in Ottawa. He is the one and only Arjun Singh Buller, and he joins us right now via the Magic Skype. Arjun, how are you?
Good, Ariel. Thank you for having me. What an honor to be here once again, my man.
Yes, it's great to talk to you. Is it sunny in there? What's going on?
It is. You know, I got a little touched up this fight as well, and it's sunny, so I thought it was a nice day to bust out the shades.
I appreciate it. Were you happy with your performance against Juan Adams on Saturday?
Extraction begun.
Yes. You know, we got the W. Most importantly, we got the W for sure. You know, one of the, if not, you know, probably the biggest guy in the division. Maybe him, maybe Black Beast, right at the top for size. But, you know, end of the day, we got the W. But not satisfied. You know, want to get finishes, want to be exciting, want to push towards that. And that's what we're going to turn our attention to moving forward.
And so you revealed after the fight that your contract is up. Why did you bring this up afterwards? And sometimes it's become sort of a thing where fighters will bring this up leading up to the fight.
Everything's aboard and ready to go.
You mentioned it to reporters afterwards. Why did you do like that?
You know, it's because it's not a reality until the fight's over. Then I'm officially a free agent and my contract's up. You know, so the most important task at hand is to get the win and the fight. And once that, on the back end of that, then officially my contract's up. And that's, you know, most important to me, a top priority right now. To make sure we handle things accordingly. I've got a great management group that I trust that are going to lead that for me moving forward and make sure that we stay with the UFC and continue building here.
Were there any talks leading up to this fight about signing a new deal beforehand?
Yeah, there was. There was, the contract is managed, but again, I stay out of it. I'm the type of guy, look, I have management, I have it for a reason. They handle all that type of stuff, so I can just focus on training. I'm a fighter, that's my job. I'm not a business guy or that type of thing. So, they did reach out, I believe, and connected with management. And I just, management was like, let's just focus on this fight, and we'll get to work thereafter. And that's
where
we're at. The first contract has been great. Obviously, I have one hiccup there. But we've got a winning record in the UFC, learning to win, but also now gonna, it's how you win as well moving forward. And that's what I want to evolve to, and that's what I want to push myself towards.
So if that is the case, like you said, 3-1 in the UFC, 3 wins via decision, are you at all concerned that they will not extend a contract your way, a new contract?
I don't like to get into what-ifs and worry for things I can't control. End of the day, I'm there. I'm a fighter. They have, they run the best MMA promotion in the world. I feel, this is where I want to compete. I bring family to the team. I hope to see guys. I got a lot of passion, man. I like pushing the envelope. Sometimes that gets me in trouble. Added ambition. Even my management always tells me, stay patient. So I'm learning that aspect. But end of the day, I want to be I want to represent 1 Billion Strong.
It probably would come as no surprise. It feels like had you lost this fight, maybe then, you know, the pendulum would have gone in the direction of not re-signing it. Did you feel like there was a lot of pressure on you to go out there and play with that free agency hanging in the air?
I tried to put that behind me. Honestly, it weighs on you a little bit.
San Jose Sharks game, and I believe there's the photo right over there. What was this for, and how did you get involved in all of it? You do a great job of representing your people. I mentioned last week, like, you went out and did your own open workout. Like, you really get the art of promotion, and it's not gratuitous. You just understand that with prize fighting comes, you know, going the extra mile, promoting yourself, getting people emotionally invested in your story, and you have an amazing one. This particular story, you had the Sharks game. What was it all about? How did it come together?
Yeah, first of all, you know, I just want to put it out there. Again, that's the whole ambition part. And my management always tells me be careful. You don't want to step on anyone's toes and that type of stuff, get people upset. But, you know, that's really where I come from. That's my angle for that area is, you know, it's about connecting with the people, doing unique things, and being proactive for your own brand and for yourself. That's where I'm coming from with that stuff. And that, you know, the Sharks game was cool.
Agent
was,
in need of backup.
I was in town, like I said, training down in San Jose. And the local community down there, the South Asian community, reached out to me. They said, we have South Asian night for the South Asian Sharks, and we would like you to be our guest, our VIP guest for for that. And you know what? It was very cool to be a part of. Actually, the head photographer for the San Jose Sharks used to work for the UFC too, so it was cool to connect with him. The first ever South Asian NHL player played for the San Jose Sharks, Roman Bawa. He's a BC boy from Duncan, BC. So it was cool to kind of be a part of that, honor him. For promoting diversity, all that type of stuff. And so that was a lot of fun.
And now you get to walk out with your turban as well. You feel comfortable. We can't end this now. We're just building towards something, right?
absolutely, man. We got the whole brand and kind of identity out there. We're learning how to win. I want to keep this train going, have this platform, continue to build. We got momentum behind us, and I want to win in exciting fashion moving forward. I'm excited for that.
And you're excited to fight Andre Arlovsky. Why Arlovsky? Why do you want to neuter the pit bull?
I was excited. Promoted for running. Out of Bisping like that, he had a good chuckle. That's right up his alley, that type of thing. I was just excited, man. I know they're coming. I heard that they're coming to Vancouver. And I'd like to be higher up on the card if possible. And I'm thinking, okay, hey, maybe get a bigger name out there. You know, Arlovsky, been around forever, been a former champion, seen it all. A lot of respect for him. So I don't want to get it twisted. I got a lot of respect for that guy. And still to do it at a high level at the age he's at is tremendous. So I had to start somewhere, and that was sort of a name that came to me. I just watched his fight last week.
Right.
I was like, hey, man, maybe I fight him next, so that's sort of where that came from. But again, contract first, and then, whether it's Arlovsky, whether it's someone else, I want to win in exciting fashion. I want to get a finish and start with that.
All right. Way to represent Canadian people on Saturday. I got my flag right over here. Way to do your thing, my man. Good luck with the contract. Safe travels. Get well soon and keep us posted on how the talks go.
Thank you. Will do, Ari. I appreciate it. Tune in a couple hours. Anybody else, beat the streets. Askren versus Burrows. Can't wait.
That's right. I appreciate it. There he is. Archon Buller stopping by now. A free agent. 3-1 in the UFC. Had a nice win against a good prospect in Juan Adams on Saturday. Yes, it does seem like everyone is buzzing because of Burrows today. How about this that I saw across the wire moments ago, courtesy of the great Nolan King on Twitter? Matt Wyman is returning in Greenville on June 22nd. Matt Wyman, according to Nolan, it has been 1,674 days, 4.5 years, in between fights for Matt Wyman. Yes, Matt Wyman. His last fight, November 22nd, 2014. Little known fact, I actually text Matt Wyman from time to time. Actually, I stopped recently, but I would text him from time to time asking him what's up, because I always felt like he was one of the interesting characters in this sport. And, I can't look at the thing now, but I've always tried to ask him, like, why did he leave so mysteriously? When is he coming back? And we'd always have these funny back and forths. Look at this. This last one. Okay, maybe I'll read it later. But anyway, Matt Wyman is a fascinating character. I can't believe he's actually coming back. And he didn't tell me. Matt, you were supposed to tell me. You were supposed to give me a heads up. Hopefully we'll talk to him in the coming weeks. For now, though, let us move along to our next guest. She's one of the top strawweights in the UFC. She's coming off a hard-fought win back in February. Looking forward to what is next for her. Say hello now to... Oh, okay. I'm being told to hang on one second. I was getting all excited about Matt Wyman. I'm sorry. Matt Wyman. Okay, now we're ready. Sorry, got a little excited. Now we're ready. Cynthia Calvillo is back. And there she is. Oh, hello. Cynthia, how are you?
Hi. I'm doing good. How are you?
Who's this little guy or gal?
It's a boy. His name's Oso, my little sidekick.
Okay. What's his name? Oso?
Oso? Yeah.
What does that mean?
It means bear in Spanish.
Wow. Okay. Why'd you pick that name?
When I first got him, he's a little puppy. His face is a little sunburned. He's just like a little white polar bear, so I named him Bear in Spanish.
Cool. I can't believe that he's just sitting there. He's not even moving.
Yeah.
It's like he knows he's doing an interview right now.
Yo, he got excited when I told him I was going to go on the aerial show.
Oh, stop it.
Yeah. No, he did.
I appreciate that.
Well,
I'm happy to have him. It's great to have him, man, and you as well. Okay, so there's a lot to talk about. It's interesting timing because, of course, the title is being defended in your weight class on Saturday. But first, let's talk about you. I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, there's been some changes in your life. You're no longer at Team Alpha Male. Is that accurate?
Yeah, correct. I'm no longer training at Team Alpha Male anymore. There's just been a lot of changes since I first went in there in the last, year and a half, too. And I try to stick it